Hey everybody, Coach Talbert here, and welcome to another video where I'm helping new and potential high school esports coaches get a firm grasp and understanding on the game of League of Legends. We just had the Alabama Fall 2019 State Championships just the other week. I went to it, we had a blast. It was just an awesome event. So congratulations to Bob Jones for winning Rocket League and to Thompson for winning the League of Legends State Champions. State championship. Now, while I was there, there were also a lot of spectators that are unfamiliar with the game. We had school administrators show up, we had school board members come out, we had representatives from the Alabama High School Athletic Association, we had just a ton of spectators there, and it's, you know, we have a lot of different people from different backgrounds. And one of the questions that I was asked multiple times as we were watching the League of Legends State Championship play out was, how do we know who's winning? When we look at all this data on the screen, what does all of this stuff mean? So for today's video, or in this particular video, what we're gonna be talking about is what those numbers mean on the scoreboard, at the top of the screen, at the bottom of the screen, and you can take this information and use it multiple ways. One, for evaluation of your own players and how you can take that to try to, you know, talk to them of what maybe what they need to improve upon, to give you an idea of where your players are in the game, and to see if, you know, were they winning the whole time, were they losing the whole time, were they winning half the time and then start losing. Just all that information for you to take back and use with your program. So without further ado, we're gonna roll up to the PC and get started. Okay, so for this video, we're gonna be looking at a tryout video that I recorded for any of the students that were trying out to be part of our spring 2020 team. But we're gonna be mostly using it to look at the different numbers and things on the screen to give you an idea of what it means for a team to be ahead in League of Legends. So go ahead and hit play. And as the video plays out, we're going to talk about several things in the video. So, all right, so at the very top of the screen, you have the scoreboard. You have a blue 0, a blue 2.5K, a big blue 0 next to a red 0, and then we have a red 2.5K and a red 0. Okay, so we'll talk about each of those numbers at a time. So directly above the timer for the match, you have the blue 0 and the red 0 with a sword between it. That is how many kills have been have happened this game, basically. So kills don't win the game, however kills grant gold, and this is how many kills each team has total. So however many kills blue team has is, you know, that number goes up. However many kills red team has, that number goes up. To the left and to the right of those are the gold counts for the entire team. So right now each team starts at 2.5k. Every member of the team starts with 500 gold when the match starts, so 2.5k. And as that number goes up with more gold that's gotten, you'll see, or as each player gets more gold, you're going to see that number be reflected at the top of the screen. Now, generally, that number at the top, that gold count at the top, gives you an idea of which team is stronger at that time, which team is, you know, kind of in the lead, if you will. However, the game's not over until the other base is destroyed. So a gold lead doesn't necessarily mean that team is in the lead per se. Usually that's going to come down to objectives, but gold count is a good reflection of who is stronger at that time and who is likely to win at that moment. To the side of those, you have a picture of a tower with a blue or red zero there. That is how many towers each team has taken as a team. Now, that number is kind of important. It is directly reflected in the gold count of the match, but each team has to get through at least 5 towers before they can take the enemy team's nexus. There are 3 towers per lane, and then there are 2 towers guarding the nexus. So it is possible for a team to take 5 towers and not be anywhere trying to take the nexus, but a team would have to take at least 5, you know, 3 in any given lane plus 2 at the nexus before they can start taking out the base. So looking at that tower count too, that's something to consider. How close is any given team to taking the base by looking at that tower count. So let's skip ahead a little bit. We're gonna go to 7 minutes, 43 seconds into the video. And you'll see here, each team has 4 kills. Neither team has a tower. And you see the gold now very different. The red team is a 12.4K gold amount, and then the blue team is 11.8. So at this point, we would look at this and we could generally say the red team is a little bit stronger because it has more gold. However, there's some other factors in there. It's possible that they have that gold and then they haven't itemized correctly, or they haven't even spent the gold yet. All those are possibilities. So when we say it generally, that reflects that one team is stronger than the other. Let's scoot forward to 1503. And now you start to see that gold lead grow a little bit. You see the red team has taken 2 towers now to the blue team's 1 tower. You see the gold lead now is 25.9 to 23.2. So looking at that, now we have at least a 2K gold lead, almost a 3K gold lead. The red team, we would look at this, okay, they're, as a team, they're stronger than the other team, you know, generally speaking. Okay, so that is a good idea, good indicator of, is your team winning or not? Not necessarily the kills in the middle, but that gold value next to it, because the kills, although the kills in the middle do give you gold, there are other things that go into it. We're about to talk about this now. There are other factors that go into this gold value here. A team could have less kills in the game, but still be winning. We're gonna talk about how that's possible. So we're gonna look at that by observing the scoreboard at the bottom of the screen. So we're gonna go look at the bottom. We're gonna go back to when minions spawn. And in the champion pictures down at the very bottom of the screen, each student's champion is represented by that little picture there. And then next to those pictures, there's a yellow number. You're gonna see those numbers change as the game progresses. Those numbers represent how many minions or jungle camps that students or players have taken in the match. Each of those are worth money. If a student is near a minion that dies, or near a jungle camp that dies, they don't get credit for it here. They may get, you know, some ambient gold depending on the situation, but in this particular, this shows how many they've actually taken. So not only do you have the gold lead at the top that tells you which team is beating the other team in a general sense, you also have some individual statistics at the bottom of the screen that tells you which players are outperforming other players. So that's a really neat feature there. So you can see if your team is winning, looking at the data at the bottom of the screen, you can kind of get an idea of, you know, who was the person that was doing the best, that was really helping out the team there, and maybe, you know, praise them for that. So that's called creep score. Generally speaking, a good average creep score is about 10 minions per minute of play. Now, it's not going to be perfect. It's never going to, you know, very rarely are somebody going to have numbers that good. But it does give you a general rule of thumb. So let's skip forward to 6 minutes. If I go to 6 minutes game time, if somebody is just farming minions really, really well, they're going to have pretty close to 60 CS or creep score here, these yellow numbers. So let's go to 6 minutes, 606. I'm gonna let this play out. Now at this time, you see there's been a lot of fighting, a lot of skirmishing here, so not a lot of farming. But looking at the mid lane here, you see Vladimir's got 41, Tristana here has 32. So Vladimir has had more income on his character than the Tristana has just by farming. Now, the place holders here are a little wrong. So he's actually, the Vladimir is going into the Akali. So things are a little messed up there, but he's still out farming the Akali, 43 CS to 39. He also has no kills, no deaths, no assists. That's what these three numbers are next to the CS. So 000, the first one's kills, the second one's deaths, the third is assists. Players get gold also for kills and assists. So if all things are even and both players have the same amount of CS or the same creep score, then you can look at their kills and determine, okay, how well is that person doing? So let's look at how crazy this top lane matchup is here. Looking at these two players at the top, we have the Set and to the Silas. Set has 43 CS to Silas's 16. So Set is way out farming the Silas. He's got a whole lot more gold on his champion. Not only that, but he also has two kills on his champion. So that shows that Set is outperforming the Silas on an individual level, not even looking at team. Because if you look at the team data at the top, it's 11.8K to 11.6K. So it doesn't look like there's, well, now it's more, now it's 12.4. But it didn't, at that time, it didn't look like there was a very substantial lead that the red team had. However, looking down at the individual scores at the bottom, you'll see that the top laner for the red team is definitely dominating this matchup here. So the blue team's hanging in the match by what they're able to do elsewhere on the map, such as the Tristana is at 40 CS to the Lucian's 27. So Tristana's doing better than the Lucian in farm, but Set is outperforming the Silas in farm. So all those things kind of balance out. All those individual performances by the students go into that gold count at the very top. So basically, the way you would use this data is to, maybe if you were doing tryouts, this is what you would look at. If you have two different students that want to play top lane, and this was your matchup, and you have this Set player's like really outperforming the Silas, then clearly he's stronger. That would be a person to keep an eye on. The Silas can then evaluate his performance. It's okay, I didn't farm as well as I could have. I also gave away three early kills before the 10-minute mark in the game. So little things like that. So to recap real quick, how do we know which team is winning? Gold lead kind of determines that. Looking at those gold totals tells you which team has a gold lead, which team is stronger. And then you can look at individual performance by looking at the data here at the bottom. Look at how well they're farming, looking at their KDAs. Now let's go a little bit far. Let's go 19 minutes into the game and show you how it may be a little bit different. So you can see how this gold lead has changed now. Now it's 32.3K to 29K. You see, red team has four towers to the blue team's one. So this gold count here is being affected by all the different things around the map that the players are doing. So even though the blue team has about the same amount of kills as the red team, there's only one kill short. Notice the red team has taken seven towers at this moment. So they are in the lead at this time. It doesn't matter that the kills are right there neck and neck. Look at the tower count. Look at the gold count. There's almost a 5,000 gold lead at this moment. So these are the things to consider for sure as you evaluate game plans or evaluate gameplay to determine when did we have the lead, when did we lose the lead, so on and so forth. So I really hope you'll take this information back to your students, back to your program, incorporate it in how you evaluate film, how you look at the videos of matches that you've played to determine how long we had the lead, when did we gain the lead, when did we lose the lead, and then also evaluating individual performances of students. So that's it for this video. Thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next time.